Hello and welcome to Denny's Tips. In my previous tutorial, I taught you how to create and use a tone chart in Photoshop. However, things are different in Lightroom, and we can't really create the same tone chart in Lightroom as we can in Photoshop. Using the tone curve and color adjustments in Lightroom is also quite difficult. So to make things easier, I created for you this chart. You can place your own photo in the chart and use it as a reference. Then you can take the settings that you apply to this chart and use it as a Lightroom preset that you can apply to your other photos. But this chart goes a bit further than the tone chart that I introduced in my previous video. And instead of just letting you use the tone curve easier, it also has a color chart that makes color adjustments easier as well. This technique is useful whenever you want to color grade a single photo with good control, or if you want to create an entire pack of Lightroom presets to share with others. So if you're interested, keep watching and I'll show you how it works. Before we begin the tutorial, look at this gradient. If you notice any color banding like this, or like this, anywhere in your chart, it means that there might be something wrong with your monitor's color calibration. The gradient you see right now should appear to be grayscale on your monitor. Check carefully from left to right. If you see any color banding, try recalibrating your monitor or just temporarily disabling your monitor's profile for now. When learning to use the tone curve, it's important that this chart looks accurate on your monitor. Grayscale with no color banding. Okay, so hopefully everything is fine. Let's start the tutorial. First, you need to download a chart that I made for you, and you can find the download link in the video description. There's two charts you can use. One is for Lightroom and the other is for Photoshop. For this video, I'll be showing you how to use the chart in Lightroom. I'll get to a Photoshop chart in another video. But to use this chart in Lightroom, you'll first need to place a photo of your choice inside the chart. If you have a photo in Lightroom, you can just right-click on the thumbnail and go to Edit In, Open as Smart Object in Photoshop, and then place the tone chart you want over your photo. You can use any image editing software to do this, but I already have one done here. When you have your image loaded, switch to the Develop mode. Basically, this chart lets you see what you're doing when you use the tone curve and color adjustments. Let's start with the tone curve. This tone chart makes using the tone curve way easier and more accurate than it is to do by hand. If you haven't seen my previous video on how to use the tone chart, you can click here to watch it. It's for Photoshop, but it has some great tips on how to use the tone chart and how you can use it to create a lot of different effects. For this tutorial, I'm going to be creating an effect similar to one of my favorite photographers, Masashi Wakui. He takes amazing photos, but what makes the photos really stand out is his post-processing style. It's very strong, it's noticeable, and because of that, it's also very suitable for this tutorial. Just a note, this chart is useful even if you're creating very subtle effects like film looks. You can also use it to experiment and come up with your own effects from scratch, instead of doing what I'm doing and trying to replicate someone else's effect. But as a demonstration, I'll be replicating Masashi Wakui's post-processing style to give you a very brief look into color grading, but also because it's easier for you to see what's going on because his effect is just very strong and noticeable. First, I'm going to look at one of Wakui's photos. I like this photo here, so I'm going to try to replicate something similar or at least inspired by it. Now, it's probably not going to look exactly like it, and it doesn't have to be. But anyways, when we're analyzing effects, the first step is to look at the shadows and highlights. So we can see in this photo that the blacks have been lifted, so the darkest areas have been made brighter. There's also a slight blue-green tint. If we look at this light here, we can see that there is a yellow tint, so that's something that we can keep in mind. Over here, we have some reds. Now, he might have used the gradient map in Photoshop to do this, but you can get something very similar with just the tone curves. So I'm looking here, and I'm pretty sure it's not in the whites, and it's also not in the midtones. So I'm guessing that it's in between, which is probably the highlights. So I'm just going to keep that in mind. So now that we know what we want, let's try creating it in Lightroom. First, go to your tone curves adjustment. There's two tone curves mode in Lightroom. Simply put, one is for beginners and it restricts what you can do so that you don't mess up your photo. The other is for advanced users and it gives you way more flexibility and control, and that's the one that we're going to be using. If you don't see it, you can click on this button here to switch between the two modes. Don't be scared by the tone curve. It's actually quite easy when you use the tone chart. So start by selecting this targeted adjustment tool. This tool lets you point anywhere in your image to create a point on your tone curve. But instead of clicking on your image, we're going to click on the chart and drag vertically to adjust the values. You'll notice that there are three rows in the tone chart. The top row is the 5-zone chart, which gives you the blacks, shadows, midtones, highlights, and whites. The second row is for finer control in case you need to target more specific tonal ranges, such as one in between like the midtones and highlights. The bottom row is actually not for sampling, it's only for visualization, and the point of it is so that you can see the effect that you're creating, and it's also to ensure that your results are smooth and gradual. I'll tell you more about why this is important later. First, let's create the faded look by lifting the blacks like this, and then dropping the whites like this. I'm going to play around with the other three zones to get the tone closer to what I'm going for. When you're done, you'll get a tone curve that looks like this. It's clean and it's simple. The horizontal position of the points, they're all very even, and this is an example of a tone curve that you should be creating. Tone curves should look simple and clean. Next, we're going to start using the red, green, and blue channel. This is the hardest part about using the tone curve, but using the chart makes it a lot easier. So let's look back at Masashi Wakui's photo. And looking here, we can see that there's some blue greens in the shadows. So I'm going to go back into Lightroom, and in the tone curve, I'm going to switch the blue channel and lift the shadows up like this. And then I'm going to drop the midtones so that the blue is only showing up in the shadows, and it's so that it doesn't affect the midtones or highlights. Okay, so I'm done. Next, we're going to switch to a green channel and do the same thing that we did to get a similar color. I'm just going to get something similar to Wakui's photo instead of trying to get the same effect. So I'm just going to lift this up and do the same thing that I did with the blue channel. The next thing to do is to add a yellow tint to the whites. So for that, we're going to switch to a blue channel. Yellow is the opposite color of blue, so we can simply drag the whites down like this to reduce the blues in this area, which in effect creates a yellow tint. Finally, I'm going to switch to a red channel. I think it's in the tonal range around here, so I'm going to lift the tones in this area. But it's also affecting the other zones, so now I'm going to drop them back down like this. I want to be a little bit more precise, so I'm going to move to a 9-zone tone chart and play around with the zones around here like this. Remember earlier how I talked about the gradient here and how it should be smooth and gradual? Well, if I adjusted the tone like this, it's a very drastic change, and you can see that the gradient here, it isn't very smooth anymore. We're going from red to green, you might start getting some color banding issues. Essentially, it's like this. The smoother your gradient is, the safer it is to use in other photos. And if you're using this technique to create Lightroom presets, you definitely want to ensure that the gradient is smooth. I'm going to lift this back up. By the way, if you need to delete any points, you can simply drag the point out of the chart like this. The effect doesn't look quite perfect, so I'm going to go to the channels and tweak the settings a bit. Now, the best way to learn the tone curve is really just to experiment and get the gist or the feeling of how it works. You don't need to know exactly which tone you should adjust or what shape your tone curve should be. Really, the most important thing is you get the instinctive feeling of how it works so that it feels second nature to you. And that's really the best tip that I can give you, to keep experimenting with the tone curves until it feels like it's second nature. Okay, so we're done with the tone curve. If you want to save it, you can do it by clicking on this drop-down menu here and selecting Save. This will let you access the same tone curve at any time from this drop-down menu. You can also save this as a Lightroom preset by pressing this plus sign button here in the Presets panel. Make sure that you deselect everything and only enable the tone curves and process version options. Give it a name and then click the create button and you got your very own preset. But we're not done. What about this bottom color chart? Well, the tone curve can create the bulk of your color effect, but there's more you can do. Although some effects like the Instagram Nashville effect, it can be created with just the tone curve and nothing else. Other effects like film looks, they get their characteristic by altering the colors. And by colors, I mean the hue, saturation, and luminance. So let's get to this part. For this section here, we're going to use the HSL adjustments. You can find this by opening the HSL panel and clicking on the All tab. Once you're here, you can start playing around with the settings. I actually prefer using the sliders instead of the targeted selection tool, because when you use the tool, it tends to affect more than one color at a time like this. Here's how to use the chart. There are four rows in this chart. The first is a gradient to ensure that your results are smooth. The second is the hue, so that you can see exactly what hue you're getting. Next is the saturation, and finally the last one is for luminance. When you're making adjustments to a hue, look at the hue chart here. If you're making changes to the saturation, look at the saturation chart. Same thing with the luminance. This lets you visualize how you're affecting the colors, and it can sometimes act as a warning system in case you make any changes that are way too strong. How you adjust the color is up to you, but I usually like to start with the hue, and then the saturation, and then the lightness. Play around with these settings to get something that you like. Sometimes these color settings may not seem like they're making such a drastic change as you are getting with the tone curves, but these settings give you the unique color characteristic that you see in traditional film. That said, if you're trying to create something like a desaturated futuristic look, you can definitely do that and just desaturate everything down. As you're adjusting, make sure that you keep an eye on the color gradient. You want to ensure that the gradient is always smooth. If you get any hard spots like this, and I'm just going to do something crazy so that you can see it as an example. You can see here that the gradient isn't very smooth at all. It has a very sharp change, and if you see this, you want to go back and try reducing some of your settings to make sure that it's a smooth, gradual transition. Remember, just like with the tone chart, hard edges in your gradient might work fine on the photo that you're working on right now, but it might not look so great in other photos. The smoother the gradient, the safer it is. When you're done, you can update your previous preset by right-clicking on it and selecting the update option. Or you can save it as a new preset by clicking on this plus sign in the presets panel. Make sure that the only things checked are the tone curve, color adjustments, and process version. We're done with this chart. Congratulations for making it this far. But before we go, I want to point out two things that are really cool. First, let's look at the develop settings here. The settings are all untouched. The white balance, untouched. Exposure, untouched. Contrast, highlights, whites. Everything here is untouched, and that's really amazing because it means that your preset won't make you re-retouch your photo. What I mean by re-retouching your photo is that most people start by fixing their photos. They correct the white balance, exposure, and other settings. But if you've done this, and let's pretend we shot a wedding with 500 photos, and we fix the white balance and exposure of all 500 photos. The last thing that we want to do is apply a preset that overwrites our settings, forcing us to fix the white balance and exposure all over again. That's a huge waste of time. So by creating minimal presets like this, just like with the tone curve and the HSL, not only is it faster to render, it also saves you a lot of time. Here are some examples of effects I created using the same technique. Guys, thanks for watching this video. Now Lightroom isn't anywhere as powerful as Photoshop, and it's pretty limited to what it can do, but I hope that this reference chart will make things a little bit easier for you. Also, if you like this video, then you might like my previous video on how to match tones in Photoshop. It's a great technique, and it's the first time it's ever been taught, so if you're interested, click on the video to watch it. Anyways, thanks again for watching, guys. I hope you have an awesome day. Let me know what you think in the comments, and if you haven't already, hit the subscribe button below.